So good morning, everyone. I warmly welcome every one of you to the seminar on frequency distribution sets and probability. To start off with the proceedings, I just want to confirm whether you guys can hear me properly, and there's a whiteboard behind me, and please someone put on the chat box whether you can hear what I'm speaking, and also the video is clear. I just want to confirm that before starting off anything. Yes, okay, thank you so much. Right. Right, so to start off with, I'm Sayyaf Ahmed. Basically, I'm from Colombo. I'm a financial consultant and also a lecturer for like more than 10 years for maths and some other finance related professional courses. So I've been teaching maths and other subjects for like more than 10 years where I have been in the market, and we thought of conducting this free seminar session due to this pandemic, and students feel or they have tremendous problems and then issues in getting their subject covered and the areas covered. So we wanted to make sure everyone gets the benefit. So fine. And while I'm conducting the class, please everyone keep your microphone and the camera muted so that it will be easy for everyone to hear and without disturbances. And also meanwhile, we are in Sri Lanka, so there might be some technical problems. So maybe, therefore, if you can't hear me or if you can't see me for like more than 30 seconds, please just drop me a message via the chat box or the WhatsApp. That's fine, right? Okay, so I hope everyone has downloaded the tute. Right, and the tooth on the subject that we have mentioned earlier. Right, so I will be using both the whiteboard as well as the screen share so that you guys will be comfortable, and also we have a limited time to cover, and I'm trying to cover as my best possible. Right, okay guys, to start off with this, right, I just wanted to say this is a revision seminar where my target is to revise your content that you have studied in grade 9, grade 10, and grade 11 throughout the last 3 years. And due to pandemic and the problem, you might have missed here and there. And also I have chosen these topics to be provided as free, because this counts for like more than 20 minutes, or let's say for more than 20 marks. Okay, fine. Okay, and if you look at the frequency distribution, there are around 2 or 3 questions in your part one paper, and there's a part 1B 5-mark question, and 10 marks obviously it is converted to 5 marks, and also in your part 2, and you have a 10 mark whole question on frequency distribution. Right, so if you guys have got the tute printed, that's fine, keep it with you, or else even I can share the note with you. Yes, please someone confirm whether you can see my shared screen in the chat box. Yes, okay, thank you. Right. Okay, to start off with this, right, guys, in your frequency distribution, what we have been learning for the last 3 years is the data analysis, where we are given different type of data, and the data are to be analyzed and to perform some calculation, as well as to represent in different ways, like our pie chart, bar chart, ogive, right, your histogram, and all of these are representative, or the representative way in which we can provide the data in a meaningful way to get the decision. Because everyone is not fluent with the numbers, right, with the data or the statistics. Say for example, while you're watching a cricket match, right, if they put only the numbers in your screen, it's very difficult for you to make decision. But with nice diagram, nice pie charts, right, this batsman has scored more and this is the bowling speed and this is the graph where they have won the matches and so on and so forth, where you will be getting some sort of idea or decision very clearly in a meaningful way when we are presenting the data in the representative ways, like your pie chart and the diagram. So in when it comes to the O-level exam is concerned, since grade 10 and 11 people are here in the class, right? I try to cover the entire area that you have learned from grade 9 to 11, right? Right. So guys, please behave decently, because don't give personal message to others. I'll also send with the set with this, right? So don't send any personal message. If you have anything, please contact me or just drop me a message to me, right? Okay, send me a personal message to me. So our plan is to cover the two main areas, so the class will keep going until 11 o'clock, right? Okay. So to start off with your area, right, the charts, right? When it comes to charts, we have main two charts, the basic charts that are bar chart and the pie charts, right? When it comes to the bar chart, this is very common, and there is a question in your part one paper in within the 25 question where to get the idea or to get the data from your single bar chart or multiple bar chart, right? I'm not hoping to go through the entire tute one by one, line by line, because you guys have already covered, and this that will be kind of boring, right? So we have some colorful pictures added on here so that I just want to make the session interesting for you guys. Okay, fine. So we can be tested on two type of bar charts, that is the simple bar chart or the single bar chart, where they represent, right, where they, I hope you can see what I'm drawing on the screen. Right, the simple bar chart, where they represent only one single set of information. If you look at the graph that I'm showing here in the screen, it's from January to July, they have depicted only one set of information or one set of data. Whereas if you look at the multiple bar chart, where in particular set, you can have more than one type of data, right? So they have dotted lines and they have stripes, so there can be some other lines as well. So you see there can be two type of bar charts can be tested, the single bar chart or the simple bar chart and the multiple bar chart. The important notes here, I hope you can see the important notes throughout my tute. You will see these important notes. This is the summarized version of your grade 9, 10 and 11, where these important notes are the very tricky points where I have mentioned how the question can be tested. So make sure you at least go through these important notes carefully and be prepared for yourself, right? Okay, so this tute will be beneficial for you, not only for the session that we are conducting now, you can use until your O-levels, right? Okay, so the important, they say the exam questions may involve in answering particular question from a given bar chart by extracting, or you may be required to draw a bar chart. So this is very rare that you need to draw a bar chart, right? Guys, please unmute your microphones. Right. So you will have to sometime take the data from the bar chart and answer a particular question. Or sometimes it is very rare, but still it's possible because it's there in the syllabus, where you are given some sort of basic data and you are required to draw, or an incomplete bar chart is given and you need to complete the rest of it. That is also possible when it comes to the bar charts, right? Moving forward, right, the pie charts, right? When it comes to pie chart, very likely there's a question in your paper 1B section, right? The pie charts, where we use the pie chart to depict the data or the information using a circle. The circle at the center, a particular circle at the center, has 360 degree, where we divide the entire 360 degree into portions or into clusters according to the data we are given, right? So as you can see, the first example I have mentioned here, the expenditures, the pattern of the expenditure, where 20% for set construction, staff salaries, advertising, physical plant, so on and so forth. The expenditure patterns have been given in percentage. When it comes to an exam question, right. So when it comes to an exam question, you need to understand there are three main elements that you can focus on a particular pie chart question. That is, now if you look at, there can be numbers, right? There can be numbers, there can be percentages, and there can be angle where you need to use your particular pie chart to depict. Sometimes they will give you the number and ask you to draw or to complete the pie chart. Or they will give you the angle to find the number. Say, for example, if your income or the amount that you get from your parents, how you are going to spend it. So that the number is in terms of rupees where you can put into your pie chart and show. Or the angle can be given to you to draw it. So however, the total data set should be equal to 360 degree in a pie chart. So make sure your total data set represents the entire circle with 360 degrees. And also, it has been a practice where the number that is very simplifiable as a base of 360 is given to you. Okay, right. So moving on to an example where we will quickly work through. If you have the question, please, let's start doing this question. Just a small recap of what we have learned. The example says the following pie chart illustrates the information about the type of fuel used by 7,200 houses. So you need to underline or highlight 7,200 household, where this is going to be the total data for you to represent in this pie chart. And okay, so if you look at, see, this is a very basic question. However, you can learn the basics from this and the way, and also you can quickly revise it. And the firewood, they say it's 188 degree. Gas, it is 100 degrees, both put together 288. And the electricity is remaining and the angle is not given, right? So let's quickly go to the question and see what are the questions that has been asked. Find the angle at the center of the sector representing electricity. So this is very basic, where you can, yeah, guys, please don't draw on the screens, okay? Don't annotate it, okay? Right, the first one, the final, the angle at the center of the sector representing electricity, right? So that you can basically calculate by subtracting from 360. You have the angle at the center 360. From 360, you need to subtract, right? The 100 and the 188, where you will be getting the 288, right? 360 minus 288. What is the number you get? 72 degree. 72 degree. So that is the 72 degree is the electricity consumers percentage, right? Okay. Number two, write the gas consuming household as a percentage. So in this pie chart question, the examiner has chances, or it can be tested some other part of the syllabus, like percentages, decimals, right? Sometimes, so there can be different way of question, but based on the pie chart. So on a pie chart, what you need to understand is the total data is equal to 360 degree, and sometimes there can be percentages, right? So write the gas consuming household as a percentage, right? Gas consuming household as a percentage. So the second one, so out of 360, so for this question, actually, there are two ways, right? Either you can use your degree to represent the percentage, or even you can use the number. But the easiest thing that we can do is here, we have found 72. So the gas consuming household we have is 100. So 100 out of 360. How 100 out of 360 into 100, that will give you a percentage. Right. I'll use my calculator for the speed workup. So it's going to be 27.8%. 27.8%. That is the percentage of the gas consuming people out of this entire village. 27.8%. Find the number of firewood consumers, right? So the firewood consumers, now how to find the firewood? So now we know that the 100 degree has given 27.8%. So to find out the firewood consumers, right? So you have 7,200 people, and that is depicted for 7,200. That is depicted for 360 degrees. So therefore, what we can do, 7,200 is for 360 degrees. Then firewood consumers. So the firewood here is 188. So we multiply it by 188. So you get how much? 7,200 divided by 360 into 180. So you divide the entire data set by 360 degree, because the entire data set is equal to 360, and you multiply by the number you wanted by. For example, here the firewood consumer, 188 degree. Same way, if you want to calculate the gas consumers, you just multiply 7,200 divided by 360, multiply by 100. Likewise, you can go ahead. So this is a very basic question that we quickly record, right? So in the exam, remember, there can be question on by giving the angle to percentage to numbers, right? So there are plenty of past paper question on this pie chart. You can do it at home, right? So please practice before your exams, right? And also, I have made a very valuable thing in this. That is, if you go through, right, until the end of the chapter, right, where I have analyzed your last 10-year past paper as how it has been tested, right? I hope you can see this. Right. So this is your 10-year past paper analysis. We are starting from 2010 until your 2019 paper, right? Where I have analyzed your paper 1 and paper 2 each year. So you don't need to look around your past paper. Just take this page, and there's a column here at the end to say whether you are done or not. If you are done with that, you can quickly tick off, right? Let's say you are done with the 2010 paper and you tick off, right? So at least you will be doing 20 questions from your past paper. So this is going to be the game plan for you before the exam. And you can save your time and straight away go to that particular question and do and finish it off. If you have any doubt, you can ask me too, right? So this is a very valuable data I have given to you by analyzing your entire past paper. And also I have given the question description. You can see the pie chart over here, right? So you can select all the pie chart questions, first of all, right? So we have all these pie chart questions and do at a stretch, right? Take like 1 hour or 2 hours, do all the pie chart questions. Then whatever the question comes into exam, you can do, right? Right, okay. Guys, please keep your microphones muted. Right, so you can do that way your past paper questions, right? So moving on, to the data classification, this is the place where actually we start. Right. Right, the data classification, right? If you look at your data classification, this is based on your exam paper, right? So the data can be basically classified into discrete data and continuous data, where the discrete data are whole numbers. Now, say, for example, the number of vehicles, the number of students, number of siblings, number of house, all countables with whole numbers are basically the discrete data, right? So there can be a small question in your part one. Just to recap, just to revise, I have included it. So discrete data is where you can't subdivide it meaningfully, right? Always you have to give them in whole numbers. That is called the discrete data is all about. Where the continuous data is your weight, height, your temperature, right? All your data that can be subdivided meaningfully, right? So in the exam, make sure you identify whether this is a discrete data or in a continuous data, even in your part two paper, right? Okay. And the tally marks and the stem leaf diagram, right? Tally marks and stem leaf diagram is very rare to be tested, but still it can be tested in your part one within the 25. I just don't want to miss out anything in your syllabus. And I have just included. So I hope you guys can read, you know how to read this tally marks, and to pick, at least to pick the highest number, the 50, and to pick the lowest number, that is your 6. And at least to find the range, mean and median for this, right? So try to work on that part. And I just wanted to brush up on this, and there can be a question on tally marks as well, right? So you don't remember my name at the exam, right? We'll be without working on this particular thing. So I hope this is a very easy one and we can move on to the important stuff. Right, the frequency distribution, right? The frequency distribution, when it comes to your exam question, both the frequency distribution, non-group frequency and the frequency group are tested in your exam, non-group and group. Now, say for example, if you are given the data for like 10 or 12 data, it is easy for you to analyze and get which one is the highest, which one is the lowest, and which one is the, what is the range and what is the mean median if you are given like less than 20 data, because you have a limited time in your exam. But if you are given like 500 or 1000 odd number of or 1000 number of data, right? Say for example, the age or the weight of your school students, from which you have to pick the highest, lowest, and if it is for like 10 papers, it's very difficult for us to calculate individually. So we can basically divide the frequency distribution into two, as group frequency distribution and non-group frequency distribution. When it comes to your group frequency distribution, we group them into classes. What is a class? It is a range of set where we divide the entire data set into subdivided equal parts, right? So I have given the definition of classes and all in the tute, right? You can go through it later. But you need to understand the frequency distribution is divided into two, non-group frequency and group frequency. Based on whether it's non-group or group, the certain calculations vary. If it is like median, and we have the median class over there in the group frequency. Mean is the average. And the way we calculate is also different, right? So guys, I hope you understand. And I have included two tables here in the tute. And to show, the first one is your non-group frequency distribution, right? Non-group, where you can see the non-group frequency distribution has the score individually, and you get the tally mark and you take the frequency. So you see the scores are individually given, that is called the non-group frequency distribution. And if it is given in classes with ranges, example from 11 to 15, 16 to 20, 45 to up to 45 to 50, and your total frequency is 30. So what is the meaning of this number 5, let's say, right? The frequency is 5 for the class between 26 to 30. Right, so we don't know exactly what is it, but it's a range within which we are given the number 5, right? So group frequency and non-group frequency distribution, right? And the and again, there's an important note here. The student should be familiar to find the following on a frequency distribution, right? Guys, when you are working question in the past paper, you guys can look into these value range, right? Range, mode or model class. Mode is for the non-group and model class is for the group frequency. And median and the median class, mean and the quartiles, right? So with the quartiles, even you can calculate the interquartile range, percentile and all, right? So when it comes to the range, it is the maximum minus minimum, right? So there's a non-group frequency distribution example given to you. I hope you guys can hear, right? And here the numbers are given to you. Let's count the number of numbers we have. 3, 5, 1, 9. So we have basically 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 numbers. So we are given 11 numbers to work this particular example, where we will be using these 11 numbers, the data, to find the range, mode, median, and the mean of this, right? So let's quickly work on this to quickly brush up. Right, so the mode is, so it is the highest frequency, or it is the number of data that has repeated for more than any other numbers. So there can be sometimes multiple modes, or even there can be no mode, right? If all the numbers are repeated only once, then there's no mode. So let's say there can be 2 or 3 numbers which are repeated equal number of time, then all those numbers are known as considered as the mode, right? Okay, so moving forward, if you have any doubt, you can put in the chat box. So when I notice, then I can quickly cover that part as well, right? Because I just wanted to give a complete solution within the limited time we have. So quickly work on this, take your paper and the pencil, and please write down these numbers: 3, 5, 1, 9, 6, 4, 1, 8, 3, 5, 0. Even though it has been worked, let's work together just to make a quick revision. And remember, these numbers are not in arranged in ascending or descending order. For you to find your median, that is the middle number, it is very important for you to arrange it to ascending or descending order. So let's write in ascending or descending order itself, right? Okay, fine. So we have the numbers. If you write in ascending order, 0, 1, 1, 3. We have another 3. We have a 4, 5. Another 5, I guess. Yeah. 6, 8, and 9. Right. So the numbers are in ascending order, right? Okay. So with exam tension and within the pressure in the exam hall, please don't just go and find, because examiners are very tricky and they will, or they're trying to confuse students. So make sure you write the data set in ascending or descending order so that it will be comfortable for you. So to find the range, it's the maximum value minus the minimum value. So the maximum we have is the 9, minus 0 is the minimum number, and we have the range as 9. Okay, fine. And the mode. Right, so range, mode. So mode, what is mode? It is the highest occurrence of data. Now, out of this data set, if you see, there are 3 numbers which has repeated. The numbers are, you can see the number 1 has repeated twice, number 3 has repeated twice, and number 5 has repeated twice. So number 1, 3, 5, all 3 numbers are mode. And not this particular point. Right, there can be many modes or even no modes. If there's no any number has repeated for more than any other numbers, then there's no mode. Or sometimes there can be many modes, like this example, 1, 3, and 5, right? Okay, and the median, right? So the median is the middle number. Say for example, if you have set of friends and where you assign them or you arrange them in ascending or descending order of their height, and you pick the middle person is the median, right? So where the median is to find the middle. So the middle value of the data set. Here the data set needs to be arranged first. So that's very important, where you need to arrange your data first. Please arrange the data. Arranging meaning to ascending or descending order, right? Okay. And the median, the for you to calculate the median, the equation is, everyone knows it, n plus 1 over 2 term. If you don't know, that's fine. This is the time to learn, right? This will save like 2 marks in the exam, right? So n plus 1 over 2 term, where we have 11 numbers here. So n is 11, the number of data we are given. 11 plus 1, that is 12, divided by 2 is the 6th term. So 6 is not the number. As I'm involved in paper marking, some student write 6 as the answer. Please don't do that. It's the 6th term, right? So remember, it is the 6th term. So go to the data set and find 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The number 4 is your 6th data, right? So number 4 is your answer. Then what is the mean, right? Definitely there'll be a question on part 2 as well on mean. We will be going to that as well. So mean is the basic average, where you will add all the number and divide by the number of data you have. Sigma fx over sigma n, or even sigma f over sigma n, because there's no middle value here. So note these formulas, right? So write down all these formulas in a particular sheet and paste on your wall, so that for the next upcoming 6 days, you can see them, right? And you can recall. Right. And one more thing I just want to say is, so since we have 11 numbers or the odd numbers here, right, finding the median is kind of easy. And what if you are given 12 numbers, right? If you are given 12 numbers, how are we going to find this? 12 plus 1, that is 13, divided by 2 is going to be 6.5th term, right? So when there are even number of times, so it's 6.5th term, meaning, right, if you get in decimals, so you have to add the 6th term, 6th plus 7th, and you divide by 2 and you get the middle number. So it can be in decimal as well. This is only if you get even number of data, where your answer will be decimal. Even sometimes there can be 8.25th data when you're finding quartiles. Then you add the 8th and the 8.5th, you divide by 2. So likewise, you can do that. So somehow you need to get the middle of it, right? Okay, so I hope you guys are clear with mean, median, mode, and the range, right? The basic of the non-group frequency distribution. And let's quickly move on to the quartile. Quartiles is where your data set is dispersed, or your data set is deviated or differentiated as to 25% of your data. Say, for example, your data, you have 100 data, you divide it to 25, 25, 25. So like you have first quartile Q1, median is the Q2, Q3 is the third quartile, and you have the total data, right? And there are two diagrams given in the paper. I hope you guys can see and you can go through it. And there's an example. I hope this is the same example which we worked through. Yes, the same example we are using to calculate the first quartile, second quartile, third, and the interquartile range. Take a paper and a pen. Let's quickly work on this, right? So the first quartile is basically 1 over 4. That is the 25% of the data. 1 over 4 into n plus 1 term. So the quartile 1 we calculate is 1 over 4. Here, how many numbers are there? Let's quickly check with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, yeah, it's the same data, 11 numbers, right? So it's 1 over 4 into n is 11, n plus 1, that is 1 over 4 into 2, 12, that is 1/4 of 12 is the third term. Third term is your first quartile. So arrange it in the ascending or descending order again, which I have already arranged here. And your third number is 1. That is your answer for the first quartile. Right? So that's number one is your answer. And also, please don't leave three as the answer. Okay? Right. Even for grade 10 students, this will be important. And the second quartile, that is the median, right? The middle number, right? Same equation that we used here. 1 over 2 means the, here it's the 2 as the denominator, here it's as 1 over 2, same thing, right? So 1 over 2 into n plus term, then the answer you have, we have already found is 4. And the third quartile is 3 over 4 into 12. 3 over 4 into 12, right? That is your third quartile. Please don't draw on the screen, guys. So it's the 12 and 3 into 3, 9. So it's the ninth data. It is a ninth term, right? And the answer is 6, if you look at this, right? And the interquartile range is IQR, that is Q3, minus Q1, that is 6 minus 1, there we go, 5. Right, okay. So I quickly repeat the quartiles. You divide the entire 100% of your data into divisions of 25% each, where you are first 25%, that is 1/4 is your quartile, first quartile, and your 50% is the second quartile, 75% is your third quartile, and you can find the interquartile range by dividing the third quartile minus the first quartile. Right, so that's the end of the non-group frequency distribution, right, where you are tested in your part one paper. The most important part here, we begin here, is with the group frequency distribution, right? Where the group frequency distribution has right. So the group frequency distribution we have, right, is with a table where the classes are given to us and the frequency is given to us, right? Finding the group frequency distribution, right, has a question here on for us to calculate the values, right? And we will quickly go through the area of the group frequency with an example where we will be quickly calculating it, right? Okay. If you look at the example, the number of iPhone 12 sold in a phone shop and their respective customers' age are given in the following table, right? And you can see the classes are given to you starting from 8 years up to 42. And each of the class has some sort of number of iPhones that they have already sold, right? And 5, 13, 22, 16, 10, 7, and 7. Okay, right. So if you look at a class, right, I have given in short what is the meaning of class, class limits, the number that are the lower numbers, and the class boundaries where you divide it with the decimals, right, and you change it with the decimals, and the upper class boundary and the lower boundary, right, and the class interval, right, these are your quick recap notes, where class size is the upper boundary minus the lower boundary. It's not the limit, okay? And or you can calculate using the limit, upper limit minus the lower limit plus 1. That is also an alternative equation, right? I hope you guys have done this, and also you have the note printed already. Okay, and the middle value, mid value is the lower limit, and you add lower and the upper limit, and you divide by 2. For example, for the first class, I have done 8 minus 12. That means 8 to 12, you can add 8 and 12, the lower limit, and the upper limit, you divide it by 2, and you get 10 as your mid value for the first class, right? Okay. And in the frequency, you can see 5, 13, 22, 16, 10, 7, and 7. So when finding the quartile, should we want to arrange them in ascending or descending order? Yes, it is a must, right? This is similar to finding, or this is similar to finding your median, right? Where 25% of the data, 50%, 75%. So you need to have it. It's better to have it in ascending order, as that's the normal routine. Fine. And the model class. So finding the model class is where in your frequency column, if you find the highest number, that is your model class. Mod meaning it is the number that frequently recurring, right? So here it is, the 22 is the frequency, and therefore 18 to 22 is your frequency distribution and the model class. Cool. Moving on, right? The median class. What is the median class? It is the class, right? It is the class which has the middle value, usually cumulative frequency. So what is the meaning of cumulative frequency, right? You need to have the cumulative frequency and find the total data divided by 2 to find the middle class or the median class in a data set that is given as a group frequency distribution, right? Okay. And if you look at the table, I have added some more columns, right, to make sure the other data can be added on. But in the exam, don't expect to be given these added columns. You are most likely to be given this data set in a horizontal way, and you need to draw it in a vertical way to when you're answering, because this is tested in part 2, right? I swear this is there in your paper, right? The mean calculation and the stuff has been there in throughout your paper. If you look at my past paper analysis, this has been there for the entire paper series, right? Okay, so let's quickly work on this. The mean is the average. So when we calculate the mean specifically, right, mean is the most question, the most important question has been tested for a while. And for us to calculate the mean of a group frequency distribution, there can be two way of calculating. One is using the normal mean, or we say general mean, where everyone is familiar with sigma fx over sigma n, right? Everyone loves this in equation. But unfortunately, if they say, right, using any other value or using general mean or using assumed mean or any other, then you must definitely draw your table accordingly. Fauzi Ahmed. Right. General mean value. So the mean value using assumed mean, right, using the frequency distribution. So there can be two equations. So there are two equations where the mean equals sum of all the data. So sigma fx over sigma f. And we have another one, assumed mean plus sum of all the deviation, that is your sigma fd over sigma f, right? Fine. And let's work on both of them, right? We will be working on both the ways, okay, to find the answer for, right? Cool. So I have taken the same data into this Excel, right? The class interval and the frequency. These two are the data that was given to you originally. And I have added the cumulative frequency column to show the way how it is added. The cumulative frequency is added by adding 5 and 13, you get the 18, right? And the 18 plus 22, you get the 40. Likewise, you can keep adding the other column to find the median class, right? in the model. Fine. The mid values are calculated as the median. So already we have discussed how to find the mid value, that is the lower limit plus the upper limit over 2, right? And by calculating, right, I have assigned some equation here. So we've calculated the mid value. So this is the general mean equation where we find the sigma fx, that we can multiply the frequency f into the mid value. So each of the f into x values will show you, right, for example, 5 into 10, that is your 50. You will have to add this table in your exam for the part 2, right? And so on, 13 into 15, likewise, 7 into 40, 40 to 80. So you take the total sigma f 80, sigma fx 1910. If you divide 1910 divide by 80, you get 23.875 is the average number of iPhones. But since this is a decimal and also this is not a continuous data, the number of iPhone cannot be a continuous data, so we give in a whole number, right? Round off to the next whole number. Right, so the answer is 24 iPhones. So this is the method everyone loves, but unfortunately, if the examiner specifically mentioned, right, to use the assume mean technique, definitely you have to go for that. Or you say assume mean or any other alternative you will see in past papers, then definitely you can use any method as you want, but whichever the method you found, right. So what is the purpose of adding cumulative frequency column to the table? Right here, the way how I just wanted to show the way how it is calculated, but the cumulative frequency is to calculate the middle class, the class which has the median value. So you take the total data 40, total frequency 80, divide by 2, that is the 40, right? 40th data. So the 40th is somewhere here. So 18 to 25 is your 18 to 22 is your median class. Right, so we add the cumulative frequency column, right, to find the middle number. So the middle, so the out of the whole people who are the 80 people who have bought this iPhone 12, who is the person who has bought in the middle, right? Okay, so to find out where that person belongs to which age that person belongs to is the cumulative frequency's all purpose, right? Okay, so the 1910 divided by 80 yes, so if they ask to find the mean, we can use the fx, yes, right? So if it is not a muscle, so fine. If they say any method, that's okay, but if they say or any deviation or any assume mean thing in the question, it is recommended to use the assume mean, right? But however, in both, you will be getting the same answer, right? More or less same answer. So there can be slight decimal point differences, right? But there are two possible ways in calculating. But if you look at the Word document and you'll see the mean value using the assumed mean, right? Where we find, right? And we find assumed mean plus sum of all deviation divided by number of data points. That is A plus sigma F D over sigma F. So how to work on that? So I have already worked that as well in this Excel sheet to save our time. We have the same data set we use here. The same data set. Right? And these are the three columns you need to add when it comes to the, when it comes to using the FT or using the sum of the assumed mean, right? So what is an assumed mean? In most of the exam question, assumed mean is mentioned as the mid value of the model class, right? Because that is the class which has the number highest number of people. So therefore, the mid value is 50, right? So that is the 50%. So that means at least the mid value of the model class. If nothing is mentioned, you are strongly recommended to find the mid value of the model class. Go and pick the highest frequency and get the mid value of that particular class. So in my working, the 20 is the assumed mean A, right? We consider this as the A. 20 is our A. Because the A is very important, because the A plus or minus sigma FD over sigma F, right? Okay. So we have the deviation. How to find this deviation? The deviation is always calculated by subtracting the mid value minus a. Mid value minus a. That means x minus your assumed mean gives you the deviation. But how much it is, it has been deviated from x to a. So more or less the upper numbers, the upper part of the table will consist of the minus and the lower part will consist of positive numbers. So make sure you multiply all these deviations into frequencies, right? And you take the F into D, FD column, and you will get the minus number here and all positive numbers, and you get the total, net total, which is 310, right? So 310 is your F into D, right? The sum of the frequency the FD, right? Frequency into the deviation, right? So F sigma FD is 310 divided by sum of the frequency, that is 80 people have bought iPhone. So the 310 divided by 80 gives you a decimal, 3.875. Make sure this decimal can sometime be negative, right? So understand, it can be 20 minus or plus, right? But most of the time it is plus, but there are classification where you can work and see there are minus values, right? So you need to divide or deduct it from the assumed mean, right? So in this question, 20 plus 3.875, if you divide 310 by 80, you get 3.875. Cool, right? But if I compare, right, both answers, right, the group frequency gives 23.875, and if the general mean and also the assumed mean gives the same 23.875. So there's no difference in this, right? However, the method matters a lot, because in the exam, if they mention specifically to use this method, right, for even for grade 10 students, you can learn this, right? You'll learn this in your upcoming course, right? So 1019 divided by 80 sigma fx, then you get 24 iPhone. So basically it is a 24 iPhone in both cases, right? So that is, yeah, that is the end of the calculation part, where we are statisticians, or we are some sort of yes, you have to round off the mean according to the data you are given, right? So that means, right? So we can round, so how can calculate the mid value? I'll share. Yeah, how find the assumed mean. So you can calculate, or you can even round off the mean value. If it is a continuous data, better not to round off, right? Because it can be in number of kilogram or gram or centimeter or meter. But if it is a discrete data, right? That's why I explained you. The discrete data is on counts, right? Where you will calculate. So in this example we worked, it's the number of iPhone 12. So that means you have to have the whole number. You can't have in decimals. Cool? Right. So starting off with the histogram, this is the place where we have the charts, right? The way we represent, starting from histogram to frequency polygon, right? To our cumulative frequency curve, and how to use the quartiles using a frequency polygon, right? So the basic difference between the histogram, right, and the bar chart that we discussed earlier, there are two main differences between the histogram and the bar chart. Number one, the width of the charts are not equal in histogram, where we can divide, or we can deviate, or we can differentiate the width of the bars. And also there is no gap between each bar in histogram, whereas in your normal or your multiple bar chart, you can have column, the gap between each column, right? Okay. So now when it comes to the histogram, right? Histogram, the theoretical note is already given to you, right? And the area of the column is proportional to the relevant frequency. But here, one of the most important thing you need to focus is in your data set, right? And you are given a data set, or at least to most of the question are in part 1B section, where part of the table and part of the histogram is given to you, where you will have to fill the table by looking at the histogram and fill the part of the histogram by looking at the table. Here, the most important thing every student needs to understand is there can be unequal classes. Now, if you look at the question that we worked here, 8 to 12, 13 to 70, up to 38 to 42, every single column or every single class is with the same deviation or the same class width, we call it. Class intervals are same. If the class interval is different, we need to have a small adjustment to the frequency because we are going to shorten the height and to increase the gap or to increase the widen or to, we are going to widen the horizontal width of each of the bars, right? So if you look at this, right, I hope you guys can see the screen shared. Right, if you look at the first one, right, you can see there are two or actually four data set is taken here, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. If you look at the first column and the second column, first column is 4 times greater than the second column. And even the second and the third column or third bars are same. And the fourth one is like 3 times of the second. So that means these are all unequal bars where this is the typical feature of the histogram, right? And we will have the histogram, right, in this way, and we have to adjust the height, right? So if you find out there is a class without a particular uneven or without equal width, then you have to adjust it by using this equation. The adjusted height is actual frequency, the frequency that you will see in the table divided by the multiples of the column width. That means, if, for example, if you want to find this one, so if you compare with the second and the first, it is 4 times greater. So you can see the frequency over here is 40 into 2.0. That is 80 is the frequency. Even though it is 80, it is given as 2.0. That is 2 because there are 4 times it is the its width is greater than the second. So you can have a common width as well as other width, right? So in this question, now there's a question, if it is like 23.345, that means if you round off and get the, or if you divide and get the decimal number as to 3 decimal places, if it is a continuous data, round off to second decimal place and keep it. If it is like kilogram, 23.35 and just leave it. If it is 23.345, if it is a discrete data, number of 5-4, go to the next rounded number, and the examiner is a bit flexible, and I have seen the marking schemes and I have involved in the marking, and there can be, they allow answer for 23 or 24, but it's the next one, right? Next whole number. I hope it's clear, right? And quickly move on. Right. And the frequency polygon is where usually we can use the frequency polygon, or we can draw the frequency polygon, right, using a histogram, or even without histogram, we can draw the frequency polygon, right? So guys, what you can do is you can go to the past paper section, right, and figure out all the group frequency question and do a frequency polygon. All the histogram question are there. So you can do all the question with relevant to histogram and finish it off. So since it is tested from 2010 to 2019, every single paper, the red color, you can imagine or you can guess which question is going to be. Definitely there are questions on this, right? So basically the paper is out, right? So if you go through the whole tute and you get the understanding, then definitely we are up to. Right, and how to draw a frequency polygon? So drawing a frequency polygon can be of two ways. One is using the drawn histogram, where most of the time it is tested in that way. Or there can be the second one from the mid values of the frequency class intervals. Or the, even that is also possible. You can see there are two images I have shared, right? And make sure these dotted, the plottings, you need to do it on the mid values.